Welcome to this week's service for the congregations of Fortingall, Glenlyon, Kenmore and Lors, Dull and Weem, Aberfeldy, Grantley, Logierate, Strathtay and Tenandry. And welcome to any other people who are joining in our broadcast this week. This week we are up in Glenlyon, at Glenlyon Church. Regular services stopped here last year, but we still have occasional services through the year, so it's still a consecrated place of worship. I'm sure for many of you coming up, the Glen here has been a favourite outing in easier times, and you've probably stopped off at the post office cafe and enjoyed one of their magnificent slices of cake. I can recommend the raspberry and lemon. Anyway, I hope you will enjoy seeing some of the scenery here and will feel something of the peace and calm of this special place. You maybe realise by now that I do have a special interest in history. It was my subject before I spent most of my working life in the nuclear industry. At times of crisis, when there doesn't seem to be a precedent in our own lifetimes of what we're going through, people often look to the past for some parallels, for some guidance. And very often on the radio and TV, historians are trotted out to speak about past times and what they might have to teach us. Of course, there are no exact parallels, but there are things for us to learn. For us as Christians, it's good to be reminded of what our forebears in the faith lived through and how they coped. And also to be reminded that Christians have worshipped in these glens and in the Strath for generations. It's certainly true of this place. As at Fortingall, there are connections here which go way back to the time of the missionaries from Iona. The wee church here at Innerwick was built in 1828, and it was part of a scheme to build new churches through the Highlands and Islands. There was such concern about it that the government actually gave a grant of £50,000 for the purpose, so these were known as parliamentary churches. The idea at the time of the Reformation was that every parish in Scotland would have its own church and its own school. But that hadn't been achieved even in the 19th century. So that was the idea of building these churches, and people had to apply for part of that grant. They were allowed to spend a maximum of £1,500 in putting up a church and a manse. The design is known as the Telford churches because the design was attributed to Thomas Telford, the great Victorian engineer, but it was actually three of his subordinates who drew up the standard designs for the churches and the manses. So this is a very basic version of the parliamentary church, but they're quite distinctive. You see these windows behind me. These were standardised windows built by a firm in Aberdeen, so all the churches had to use these. Now there's something slightly odd about this one, because I checked the list of the 32 that were finally approved and built. And although the manse here was built within the government grant, it appears that the church wasn't, but it clearly is of that design. So maybe one of the local landowners put up the money to build it, but to the Telford design. Maybe one of the local historians can explain this. The parish system in Scotland, I think, is a very precious thing. It means that every inch of Scotland, even here, everywhere, is in a parish. And it means everybody in Scotland lives within a parish, whether they're aware of it or not. And it means that the national church, the Church of Scotland, is here to serve everyone in every area of the country. One of the challenges of being a national church is that it usually has to embrace a wide spectrum of theology, wider than other denominations perhaps have to. And for that reason, the Church of Scotland has always had debates about certain matters. Sadly, sometimes these have caused disagreements and even led to splits in the church. Well, in today's service, we're going to be thinking about the promise Jesus made of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a subject in which there's been much discussion and disagreement in the church. We're going to look at what Jesus said about the Holy Spirit, and hopefully we'll be reminded of things that we've always known, and maybe even find something we hadn't fully appreciated before. Our opening hymn is number 110 in CH4, Glory be to God the Father, It's played for us by Elaine Melrose, our regular organist in Kenmore and Fortingall. And the words will appear on the screen if you want to join in. Glory to you, O God, the Father who made us and loves us and adopts us into your family. Glory to you, O God, the Son, the Lamb who was slain, whose sacrifice redeemed us from slavery to sin, who washes us clean from the spots and stains which contaminate our lives and weigh on our conscience. Glory to you, O God, Holy Spirit, who comes to live with us and in us, revealing to us the Father and the Son. As we gather together in sharing this service, may our homes be blessed by your presence. May they be filled with the incense of praise and prayer. May they be the favoured place at Jesus' feet, where we hear his words. May they be the home school for disciples, where we listen for what you teach us today. May they be the place where your name is honoured and your commands obeyed. Father, we ask you to forgive us our many failings and failures, things we know all too well and which you know even better. We are sorry for the things we have done and said which do not tally with what we profess to believe. We are disappointed with ourselves. Make us clean again, ready to worship you in spirit and in truth, unhindered by the baggage from our past, unmarred by present sin. Now, in the words that Jesus taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory for ever. Amen. A reading this morning is John chapter 14 from verse 15, and it's being read for us by Lindsay Brown from Invervar.
Jesus promises the Holy Spirit. If you love me, you will obey what I command, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me, because I live. You also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus replied, If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home within him. He who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. And all I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
In these strange lockdown days, I guess that crosswords have increased significantly in popularity, both for passing time and for helping to keep the brain cells working. Every month when the Church of Scotland magazine Life and Work arrives in our house, Lorna and I sit down and work our way through the simple crossword. It usually takes us a couple of coffee breaks to polish it off. Then I start the cryptic crossword, but I never finish it. I've never been terribly good at these, but my mum and dad used to be very good because they would do the Scotsman crossword every day. And so I did pick up from them some of the tricks that are involved in solving cryptic clues. There's a kind of code that you have to learn to be able to crack these things. And you also find that every crossword setter has their own way of doing things. So you begin to learn what their particular code is. So for example, you begin to understand where you see this phrase in the cryptic clue. You'll know that certain words indicate that you're to find an anagram. So then what you've got to try and do is work out which bit of the clue you have to rearrange and which word in that clue or words actually give you the meaning of the answer. So the trick is in knowing how to work all that out. Now, in those days when my parents were doing the Scotsman crossword, the crossword setter was a man called Robert Conisborough. And it was only when he retired that it was revealed that that wasn't actually his real name. At least his surname wasn't. It turned out to be a clue in itself. So I'll leave you to think about that and see if you can work it out. Anyway, this month, for the first time, I have actually finished the Life and Work cryptic crossword. A triumph indeed. Only made possible, of course, because of the extra time I had to work on it. Unfortunately, perhaps because of the virus, you can't actually submit your results for the prize. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword. Anyway, in a crossword, there should only be one possible answer to the clue. But in Bible translation, it doesn't work that way at all. And within today's reading, there's a crucial word, and it's translated in lots of different ways. It comes at the beginning when Jesus said, I will ask the Father, and he will send you another something to be with you forever. And in the Greek original, John used the word parakletos. In the NIV version, it's translated as counselor. In the NRSV and the New English Bible, it's advocate. In the Message, you'll find that it's friend. And some translations have helper. For such an important word, you might think it's a bit unfortunate, to say the least, that the translators don't seem to be in agreement as to what exactly it means. Well, what a proper Greek scholar would do, and I certainly amn't one, is to study the word as it appears elsewhere in the New Testament, but also in the Greek classical texts, so they can find the various shades of meaning of a word like this. And where these scholars seem to get to is a literal translation of parakletos as one who comes alongside to guide and encourage. And that sounds helpful as a description of the Holy Spirit and the work of the Holy Spirit, but even that is hardly sufficient to cover all that the Holy Spirit is and does. And anyway, I wonder if John was familiar with all those classical texts. So did he really understand all the subtleties of usage that modern scholars can see? Well, maybe he could, maybe he couldn't. But there's another problem, and that is that the word John uses, parakletos, is itself almost certainly a translation of the original word that Jesus would have used in a language that we no longer have. But thankfully, none of these difficulties mean that we can't work out what Jesus meant. So if we were looking at this verse as a clue, the key to the meaning is actually not in the word which is translated from parakletos, but in the word before it, which in all the translations I can find is another. Another parakletos, another advocate, another friend, another counselor, another comforter. If you remember the version and the authorized version, the word comforter was there. Whatever we understand parakletos to mean, Jesus is telling the disciples that they have one of these already. And of course, that other is himself. So if we want to know the character of the Holy Spirit, we look at the character of Jesus. Their character is the same. If we want to know the things that the Holy Spirit will do, we have to look at what Jesus did. The Spirit will do the same. But instead of Jesus revealing the character of God through his incarnation as a human on earth, the Holy Spirit reveals the character of God in us. Instead of Jesus physically doing the things he did in his earthly life, the Spirit now does these things through us. As Jesus goes on to describe the work of the Spirit, we find that each of these translations is in some way inadequate. A counselor is someone that we appoint to advise us. So yes, the Holy Spirit will advise, and the gentle way he has of advising is something like a counselor who's never supposed to impose their own views. But a counselor is supposed to help you work towards the best solution for ourselves. But the Holy Spirit is from Almighty God, not appointed by ourselves, but sent to us, and with a quality of advice which bears no comparison with human advice. An advocate, well, that brings the idea of legal representation, someone acting for us in court, defending us. And there's something of the work of the Spirit in us, but it implies that we are appearing before a formal, remote judge. So if we carry this idea through, we can see God the Father as a formal, remote judge, which is what many people think God is. But that's not at all how Jesus describes his Father. What he actually says is that anyone who loves him, Jesus, will obey him, and he and the Father will come to that person, and he says, we will make our home with them. The Father is not remote and severe, but he makes his home with us. He is that close. For such a one, we don't need a legal advocate. Comforter is the word in the authorized version, and that goes right back to John Wycliffe's translation of the Bible into English in the 14th century. And the word had a much more powerful meaning then than it does now. The Spirit does indeed comfort us when we are distressed, and the word comforter does contain the idea of one who comes alongside us to guide and encourage. But in our limited meaning of the word comforter now, It only describes one part of what the Spirit does. It hardly begins to describe the Jesus who stood between his terrified disciples and the soldiers and said, "Let these men go." What about helper? Well, helper rather suggests that we are in charge and we call in the Spirit to assist us when we decide it's necessary. That's not consistent with what Jesus says about obeying what he has taught. And it's a distortion of the relationship between God and us as created beings. So what does Jesus tell us here about the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit is the means by which God will live in and through us. In the Spirit, we are bound to God in the three ways in which he has revealed himself to humankind: as our Father, who made us and who loves us; as Jesus, the person who makes the character and intentions of the Father known to us; and as the Holy Spirit, because God is now with us, not as a human being, as he was for the first disciples, but as Spirit, whom we cannot see, but whose presence we can know. Through the Spirit, the gulf between the Creator and we who are created has been bridged. It was impossible for us to make our way across that gulf, but God has chosen to create the bridge. In his mercy, he's allowed us into his presence, not by summoning us to his throne room, but by coming to us. Jesus also tells us that the Spirit will teach us as Jesus himself taught, and bring back to our minds the things that Jesus taught. What this promise means is that in every situation we find ourselves in, the Spirit will bring to our minds the things that we need to know. That's quite a promise. In the life the disciples were heading towards, after Jesus' ascension to heaven, things were not going to be clearly mapped out for them. Jesus didn't leave them a rule book which told them what to do in each and every situation. What he did leave them, though, was a set of principles, a lot of examples of how he dealt with things and with people, and a lot of stories. And the Holy Spirit he left with them to guide them through. It's a promise, and the extent to which we rely on that promise is up to us. The more we rely on it, the more true we'll find it to be. The first fruits of that promise are the books of the New Testament. The fruit of that promise today is yielded in our conversation, in our preaching, in our actions, in our witness. There is so much else that the Bible teaches us about the Holy Spirit, but we can't go into all of that today. But there's one other point for today at the end of our reading. With the Spirit, Jesus says he will leave with his disciples peace. I will not give you as the world gives. This is not peace as the world understands it. Out here in Glenlyon, we can experience a form of peace, and it is lovely. On one level, it is restorative. But even here, we can't totally escape the world. The restrictions of lockdown still apply. The virus can reach here. There are delivery vans going in and out of the Glen even as we are here today. And the news of what's going on elsewhere is transmitted to here instantly, just like anywhere else. And being here doesn't silence the disturbing thoughts in our own heads. Jesus made this promise of peace in the upper room before going out to Gethsemane. The peace he speaks of is the peace of the praying Christ in the garden. It is the peace which stayed with him as he faced injustice and extreme violence. It is the peace which took him through death to resurrection. It's the peace he gave the fearful disciples back in the upper room, with the doors barred and locked. In our house group, we've been watching a video series about coping with difficulties in life. And in one session, which is about peace, the presenter tells a story of the rich man who commissioned an artist to paint a picture entitled Peace. The artist went away and then came back and presented him with a picture of a beautiful scene. It could have been out here, with mountains, a river running through, contented sheep in the fields. The man said, "No, no, that's not peace. Go away and try again." Well, this time the artist painted a lovely picture of a mother with her sleeping baby. And the man said, "No, no, that's not peace." And of course, we all know that a sleeping baby is only a temporary peace. Now, maybe like me, you're getting a bit worried because the artist had to go off again and produce a third picture. And you'll be worrying, wondering what happened to the other pictures. Did he get paid for them, or did he manage to sell them on? Anyway, that's a total distraction from the story, so we're not to worry about that. So anyway, the artist went off and tried a third time. And this time he came back with a picture of an angry sky and a stormy sea. The waves were crashing onto the rocks and sending a spray up the face of the cliff before they were whipped away by the powerful gale. And high up on the cliff, on a ledge, in the shelter of a crack in the rock, he had painted a seabird sitting on its nest, unmoved and unconcerned. "That's it," said the rich man. "That truly is peace." That is the form of peace that the Spirit brings us. The inner peace which stays peaceful despite all that's going on around. The peace that survives in any external circumstances. Inner peace, because that is where the Spirit dwells. The place where the Father and the Son have chosen to make their home. I'll finish with this prayer written by a godly man that I knew. "Father, take this day of my life into your safe and loving care, so that I may live each moment to the full in peace and gladness. May I never lose your presence in any distraction that the day may bring, but remember always that you are closer to me than my own breathing, as present and life-giving as every beat of my heart. May each breath that I take and each heartbeat I make deepen my awareness of your presence and love. Amen."
Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Bring the presence of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive. Passion for your pure
Let us pray. Father, we bring you our prayers for others and ourselves. We are troubled by the disturbance to the world that the COVID-19 virus has brought. While it has disrupted our lives, we do know that in this comparatively prosperous country, we can all still be fed and given shelter. We pray for those who knew no peace before this started and who are in greater danger than we are, where the spread of the virus threatens already weakened and hungry people, where health services are inadequate or non-existent. We thank you for the work of Christian Aid and other charities in helping to bring help to the most vulnerable. May we all be moved to support them as we are able in this time as many charities struggle to raise funds. Give us your peace as we trust that the times are in your hands. Father, as this crisis continues, we worry about what may be going on behind the doors of lockdown homes, the financial worries, the jobs and livelihoods at risk, the strained relationships, children and teenagers missing their friends and missing out on their education. We pray for parents trying to cope when tensions run high. We think too of the victims of domestic abuse and violence and pray for their protection. Give us your peace as we trust that the times are in your hands. Father, we worry about our loved ones at this time. Even in our concern, may we and they know that whatever may happen, you are always close, always loving, always to be trusted. Give us your peace as we trust that the times are in your hands. Father, we worry about ourselves, whether we can go on coping, in what state we will emerge at the end, whether we will catch the virus, and whether we would survive. Through the Holy Spirit that you have put within us, reassure us as we pray that you will bring to our mind all the things we will need to know then, and that we will be given the strength we need for the day. Give us your peace as we trust that the times are in your hands. Amen. Well, we're coming to the end of our service here. Next week, Neil Glover will be leading the service again. In the meantime, if you've been worrying throughout this about what the answer to that little clue I gave you before, the answer is that Robert Conisbury's real name was Robert Warren. And now may the peace of God, the peace which only He can give us, be with you now and stay with you throughout this week, whatever it brings to your door. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you and be with those that you're praying for and those whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen.